support? Take that as a yes.
Yes.
Okay, we have guests here, Hampshire Council of Governments. We have Todd Ford and Anne Renee Lura. I guess Todd, you're going to do it.
Sure.
Can you give us an update on the electric aggregation?
Yes, should be brief and glad to answer any questions. I'm not sure, I apologize. Ken Elstein, who's our aggregation expert, set up the meeting, but unfortunately he's out of state right now, so I came instead. Certainly glad to answer any questions. I thought what I would do is just give a very brief update on where the city's application for municipal aggregation sits in the state review process, answer any questions on that, and then share a little success story on how municipal aggregation can work to save money and also bring more green energy to the constituents of a particular town. The application for the city of Northampton, along with the 37 other applications that the Hampshire Council of Governments is shepherding through the process, is currently in front of DOER. That process is in the final stages, and we had the consultation yesterday with DOER and members of various cities and towns that are participating called in. Joe Cook from the city of Northampton was on that call. And asked a couple questions of DOER. DOER asked a couple questions of him. It was pretty straightforward. Basically, then DOER takes all of that information that they have in front of them and issues, in essence, a letter of support that then joins the application as it goes to DPU for final approval. There's some good news, finally, on the DPU front. DPU has been taking some steps very recently in a couple of recent orders. If you go to the DPU website, you can look at the Lowell order as well as a recent Natick order, which is seeking to smooth the path for these municipal aggregations. Excuse me. As you know, our applications have been pending in various stages for about 3 years now. The DPU is taking a stand. It seems that that is no longer acceptable, and they'll be smoothing the process, it appears, for our current batch of aggregations as well as any future. So that is, in fact, good news. You're part of the plan as a specific part with the green energy investment, and I know that DOER, along with the city, is looking at the DOR, Department of Revenue, to see exactly how those funds can flow once they reach the city. DOER will be relying on DOR for that assessment as it goes forward. I think there's good news there, too. There's really two ways that that segment of the plan is going to be approved. It will either be approved as part of the initial application, or basically there's a B section of Section 134, Chapter 164, that allows a community to submit kind of an energy plan after an aggregation is approved. We're still waiting on which way DOER is going to recommend that your particular provision moves forward, but I'm confident that no matter which way it goes forward, it will go forward, but it'll just kind of depend on the timing of it. If it goes forward all at once, great. If it goes forward in two segments, we'll get the aggregation approved and then immediately followed with an energy plan triggered under Section B that will go through in a separate but more expedited process. Any questions on process or all those acronyms that I was using?
I'm actually pleased to hear that you're confident that our particular peccadillo, our stipulation actually has survive review at some coverage.
Yeah, I'm pretty encouraged by it too. DOER did not raise any specific issues about it. DPU, and
right.
Will remain to be seen there. But we're your advocate with it. We think it makes a lot of sense, and we're confident that it can work at the end of the day either through one of those two mechanisms.
So I do want to bring up that if it does go through the Section B piece. And then that means Northampton is responsible for all energy efficiency. So Mass Save goes away in Northampton if we go that way.
Mm-hmm.
So we would really prefer it to go, as the current package. Then we get some extra funds that we can use for energy efficiency and possibly beyond. We don't have to have them approved by, hopefully don't have to have them approved by the state. If it does go through the B piece, then anything we do has to be approved as an energy efficiency measure, if I'm correct. And we take over. We basically take over the Mass Save functioning in Northampton, which would be a lot more than we were thinking of doing for that. So even though it sounds like, yes, we might be able to go forward with that, if we, that would be another decision.
Yeah, it's also something that the council could step in and assist with and broaden the scope at that point. If there was B's, section B's for other communities, then that could be worked out at that time too. But yeah, certainly that burden is something that no city, I think, has taken up yet.
Cape Light Compact.
No, it's right. Not a city.
Not a city, right. So, but yeah, a region.
Council has
a region has done that, right?
It's a cooperative. I'll give you a cool example of how this can kind of work in a specific example. The town of Lancaster, Massachusetts, has an aggregation, and it's been approved for about a year. And they recently went out, and they have a very unique situation where the town actually owns their own solar array. They got kind of an upfront grant from the federal government. They were able to purchase their own solar array. I think they're one of the only towns, I think it is the only town in the Commonwealth that actually owns its own solar array. So they own the SRECs, and they needed to sell the SRECs. The SREC market now is, you know, whatever, around $250 or so, and if you wait for the auction, you'll get your $285. It came up with a creative idea of combining the sale of those SRECs with the aggregation power supply. And Hampshire Power, which is a division of the Hampshire Council of Governments, won the bid to provide the electricity for the town of Lancaster. And we are also purchasing the SRECs at $300 a piece for the term of the delivery of electricity. So the people of Lancaster are getting the green segment of their electricity from their own solar array that they invested in as taxpayers. So it's a really nice circular loop of public investment coming back and also providing green electricity for the people of Lancaster. And here's the kicker, we save 10% off of the default electricity rate. So all coming in under the default electricity rate. So that's just a real cool and unique example of how municipal aggregation, Hampshire Power as a supplier, and working with local cities and towns can really start closing the energy loop and keep all of this local. Hampshire Power, of course, being the only local electricity supply entity in the Commonwealth that's not owned by some mega monopolist corporation based in England or Chicago or Connecticut.
Yeah, how big was that array?
Oh, that's good.
Because we actually do own our own array.
All I know is how much dollars it's costing me. So it's actually not huge, I think it's generating about 600 RECs a year.
Okay. I think. Because Northampton does own, we own our own array and sell our own RECs.
You do?
Yeah, for about 100 kilowatt array.
Okay.
Again, not a big one, but.
Yeah, usually the big hurdle there are the tax incentives.
Yeah, we got a grant that covers the tax.
Yep,
that's a little bit better than tax part.
Great.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want to close off questions, but I'll inform you from the city's point of view where we're standing is Hampshire Cog sent the mayor a revised contract to sign to move forward. And we kind of went over that here at the Energy Commission, and we didn't see anything in specific, but I think the Energy Commission, they passed by Joe Cook. Joe Cook's taken a look at it in detail, and he's found a few spots where, it could be read a couple different ways, and it needs to be tightened up. We met with Ken Elstein, and Ken was like, well, I never thought of looking at it that way, but yes, he's right. So there is some changing to the contract that will happen based on Joe Cook's recommendation. And Joe heard that the DOER's review may also cause some changes to the contract language?
Probably not. We don't anticipate it causing changes to the contract language, only the plan itself.
Okay. So Joe is recommending that we don't sign until we actually have final language.
In the plan?
Well,
you want a final language of the plan until it's approved by DPU. And that's really the final.
Okay.
In order to file...
Yeah,
we're recommending that all towns sign the amended contract so that can be in one bundle, and it'll be the application. And then what DPU decides to do with it is,
right,
what DPU does.
Right. Okay. So for the application, but I think Joe is looking to see DOER finish its review before we.
It may not happen in that, but DOER may insist that all towns sign the amended agreement before they sign off on it.
Okay.
Well, we're glad, yeah, we didn't have any problems, I don't think, with Joe's thoughts on the contract. This has been reviewed by now 38 municipal attorneys, so.
So that's where we stand at the moment. Joe is, actually at the moment, before he makes the changes to the contracts or suggests changes to entry cog, he's waiting for the mayor to basically say, yes, it's okay to, you know, aim for these changes. And I don't see why the mayor wouldn't. They all of them just kind of protect us a little bit more. So that's where it stands.
Also staying up, that confuse things too much, but Hampshire Power is also within our organization. We'll be offering a full carbon-free product as a fixed price option for communities. And that'll be based almost exclusively, the RPS requirements will come from various RECs, et cetera, but the remainder of the electricity will be coming from New England Hydro. So we'll be proud to offer a carbon-free product if the city's ever interested. Thoughts, questions?
That's encouraging. So, I mean, it moves faster than some systems and slower than others, but.
Just one question. How much, can you tell us how much Lancaster is paying for their electricity?
9.1 cents.
Todd, just want to say thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Look forward to keep talking along.
Okay. And Renee, you were just here to sit and take notes?
Yeah, I was just here to listen in and hear what your comments and questions were.
Okay.
Yeah. So I can stay informed.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Stay warm.
That too.
Good walk back to the office.
Okay, next up, setback requirements for PV ground mount systems. I put this on the agenda. Some of the setback requirements just changed when the zoning updated quite a bit just recently. But it's come to my attention that there are a few places in town where the setback requirement for PV, ground mount PV, is more restrictive than for any kind of any other accessory use. And that made me think, you know, what are the reasons? What should be our way of thinking about setback requirements for PV? And I thought I would just bring it up to the commission and ask for a discussion to see if we can hammer out, you know, what makes sense as kind of guiding, not looking for it should be 50 feet back or whatever. I'm not looking for anything like that, but I'm looking for just, what do we want to account for? What should be the consideration just as a recommendation from the Energy Commission and you? And since Wayne, you're involved with it quite a bit, and Louis, you're involved with it quite a bit, do you have anything further to add to this?
Well, I think that there's three districts that the council's changed zoning for, so I think we match the accessory units, match ground mount and solar in those areas. We haven't started doing, we do sort of comprehensive district by district. We haven't done that yet for the districts.
An example, there's a property pretty sure it's Turkey Hill Road, it's suburban residential. The setback requirements are 50 feet in all directions, and they opted to build a woodshed next in their preferred location, which is about 20 feet from the front lot line, which is 5 feet more, and then hang the solar array on that. So it's not that there isn't a workaround, but it was more expensive than using the pole mount. So I encourage when the, I want to hear why we didn't want to do the same setbacks in some of the other districts as accessory structures.
Yeah, I mean, the history was we sort of tended to these things slowly. The current numbers came before this commission. You all endorsed it when it went through. And then it's nice to get a little bit of years of experience. So we now have 7 years of experience in all the districts. We have 6 months so far on the URA, B, and C. until the time we get to these other two districts, which have a conversation.
We did get the first serious complaint about a solar, a PV array, and a house on Riverside Drive.
Coming
on top of the
line,
and it's not handsome.
Right. I think it's,
it is allowable.
Conceptually, I have no problem with being close, but I think it's exactly this issue. It's really, sort of nice to get some experience and hear from all the people like it. I've seen that on the Riverside, but I think it hurts the place. And we also, you see some of these that are a single metal pole, and I think they're fairly attractive, or at least no worse than a shed, but that one on Riverside is different.
Well, presumably setbacks are principally to protect abutters. They're designed for aesthetic sensibilities, I suppose. Did we have setbacks for, say, large satellite dishes back in the day when they used to be really huge?
We did, because we examined, I don't know the full answer. I remember we exempted satellite dishes under 2 feet because the technology exists, so we're trying to encourage the smaller ones. But I don't remember the answer. I have a bigger one to retrieve. I know we're making it easier for the small ones, but I don't remember what the default would have been for the bigger ones.
Do we have setbacks for solar domestic hot water? For solar thermal?
I think I don't know. I have to read the language. And I don't know if they pushed PV. If they made exclusively PV, or did they? Because some ordinances don't differentiate between PV and thermal solar.
Well, as a practical matter, and I don't know whether it's technology change or just the market, until recently, everyone was putting them on their roofs anyway. It's been more recently.
They want as little of the, piping that's exposed to the cold. You want to get it off the roof as quickly as you can into the conditioned space.
Right, so, but okay, if I've ever seen things that look ugly, it's the solar domestic hot water, but the pipes kind of want help.
I think, Chris gave me a heads up, so I knew you were going to talk about this, mm-hmm. which I appreciate. But I think conceptually, I probably agree with where Chris has gone and saying the setback should be the same, but I hate looking at things piece by piece. So when we do a district, we're mm-hmm. trying to think, have a broader conversation, including asking Google what the history is, complaints are, and that kind of thing. So that's my only hesitation of weighing it now. I mean, if you ask me to vote, I'd probably vote the way Chris would like, saying the setback should be the same, but I'm just hesitant to do it until we have a little more experience under our belt.
Okay. So, how many other districts are there to go? You said three are done.
Well, two and a half are done. URB and URC are two urban districts. URA makes some changes, but only some. We know we need to go back with some mapping changes. So that's the next one on our list, is finishing up the URA. And then there's two other districts.
Okay, so there's two and a half left.
Right.
Halfway through. And do you know what the timing would be to get to the other two and a half? It sounds like half is kind of being worked on right now.
Right. No, because there's a couple of things in line first. City Council approved some higher density URB and C with a moratorium on piece, and so we have to do that as well. So certainly not between now and July, when we focus on those other, the URA and the moratorium, and then we start planning board. So we ask time, there's a bunch of change we need to do, and we ask time board to set their priorities.
In the meantime, we have our
right.
So the workaround is a Trojan horse structure. You build a shed or a large dollhouse or a doghouse that you can put it on.
It needs to be relatively substantial. I mean, in the ideal situation, it would be a wood shed.
Right.
And there is the allowance to put them over a parking area. And so, I could conceivably raise the arrays up and kind of park in amongst them. I would approve.
Right, that would be great. I think that's the intention of the zoning, is to really push those things. Roofs too, but in terms of...
Yeah, I bring it up because in Montague, we've gone through the same thing. And Montague did not just simply go with what the Energy Commission there wanted either. And I've always felt that the solar should be no more or no less restrictive than accessory use of any other kind. It's an accessory use, and aesthetics is a judgment call. So, you can put a shed up any place. But given that, I do know aesthetics is important, and this isn't my community. I only work here. I don't live here. And so I thought, it may be useful for the planning board, the planning commission, just to hear an input from the Energy Commission. So I was wondering if the commission wanted to even raise an issue and just kind of say, this is the direction we would tend to go in, or this is the direction we would give, the advice we would give. Here's where we would want to see it, based on this kind of a thought process, without having to. So I'm opening up to that kind of a motion and discussion.
One thing to add is for clarification, we're only talking about arrays that serve on-site power. We're not talking about large arrays. The arrays we're talking about are the ones that, and I forget what the 8 kW maximum and 125% of the on-site power. So it's not the 200-500%. It's not the arrays that are being used by other offset people.
It's not Ned's property, is what you're saying.
It's a ponderosa.
But that, I, and I'm not sure, I know this discussion comes up, but if you're doing triage or prioritizing, where do aesthetics fall in relation to priorities for drafting policy in this sense? Because there's a clear benefit, and it actually benefits the community, it benefits the nation, presumably. Does that trump certain aesthetic objections? How hideous does something have to be before it tips over to the point of being more important than energy savings? And that's and I'm not using it as an argument. I'm actually wondering. I don't know. And I realize that's a political question more than anything else. It's not. There is no strict criteria for aesthetics.
Mary, and then Mary's going to go first.
It's funny because I moved to a location that has no sun on the south side. I have a great empty south side roof, but there's too many trees on North Avenue. And so the only option when we had, I don't know who came out, PV Squared or something, and they went into the front yard and it's right on the property line, maybe 50 feet up from the street, but it's right on the property line in some trees, but that would be ground mounted array would be the only option for us. And we were joking with them. We're like, across the street, they'd kill us. They would go nuts on us. I still call him Mr. Noseworthy. I can't remember the ex-principal of the high school. What's his name? What? I can't remember his first name though.
Gordon.
It sounds like Gordon.
Yeah. Super nice guy, but he would go crazy. So the PV Squared guys are like, just put up the ground mount, wrap it with Christmas lights for a couple of years, people get used to it, and then put up your array. And I'm like, you're right, because it really is a matter of not so much, it's aesthetics, but it's also people getting used to it. So I think...
What equals the norm.
Yeah.
Redefining the norm.
So, and so putting up a lot of ugly sheds, the other option was put up a, a big bike shed. And we wouldn't be putting up 8 kW. It would probably be more like 4, a small. But I don't want to put a big garage in my front yard right now. So it's funny because it doesn't bother me, to see the ground-mounted arrays, because I agree that it's just worth doing. But I know that people get very upset. But after a while, they won't be.
Yeah, it's change. It's change.
In 2 years, we won't have to worry about it. But.
Yeah.
What about something on the idea of if someone wants to put in a pole mount in your pasture or whatever, you restrict it that fell over, it's safe within your property limits. So that way, when it falls into an adjacent house, if it was a tight parcel or and someone else's land, it fell over. Ground mounts aren't an issue, they're probably just going to go straight down. And that way, you can maybe push the ground mounts right up to the property line, 10 feet on side and back, and the pole mount had another restriction.
Is that something that's done in zoning?
We do that for cell towers.
You do, okay. I think radio, I think wind towers, I think have, or do we not do, we just set the setbacks on wind.
No, well, for cell towers, I know we do the height of tower in some districts and twice the height in other districts. But that's more about ice. It's actually not so much towers falling over as much as ice blowing off.
Except for mine.
I mean, you know, the other thing is looking at the steps, the possibility. It's because I think, I mean, you also look at the one Riverside that doesn't help the case for these things. So, because I actually don't think it's the solar panels, I think it's the superstructure that holds it up.
Are there a lot of requests to have ground-mounted PV? Are there tons? Are they?
The ones that are still 50 foot in all directions setbacks are the ones that we get complaints about. When it's allowed with the setbacks of accessory structure, we haven't had, I don't think we've had any complaints except for years. There were some complaints in the very beginning about safety, but the one on Riverside Drive is the first complaint about the aesthetics piece of it. You know, there's also, there are some restrictions in the historic districts too. There's actually one or two up on Round Hill Road, but they're set back a ways because of the way the site's layout, they're set back a ways.
So it sounds, Wayne, like this conversation, you're going to welcome to have this conversation when you do get to the other districts. And since you are going with accessory, you know, the same as accessory in these current districts, then maybe it, you know, is kind of a precedent for doing that in other districts.
Yeah, I mean, I think two ways it could come up. One is other districts. The other is, we do a series of housekeeping changes each year.
Mm-hmm.
To me at least, we should have a little bit of time under our belt to see how these work. So
okay.
If planning board isn't ready to do the two other districts for a while, it's not that you have to wait for that comprehensive piece. I'd just rather wait for, you know,
well,
6 months
when you're starting to solarize Northampton, it's finished.
Yeah,
I know there's a lot of permits in hand that the work hasn't finished yet. So that might be, you know, something to, and by springtime we might see some.
That would be fine. I mean, so next summer, even if we don't do get to the two districts, I don't objection to doing it separate. It's like the idea of seeing what happens.
So then, if I mean, instead of the question I'm asking of, you know, what should the criteria be, maybe the question is more, what's the appropriate timing for it? And if it is, what's the appropriate timing, can this commission have input to the planning board? I don't know, or you said, who kind of sets your agenda?
Usually the planning board.
The planning board.
The city council can, but usually it's the planning board.
Okay. So, is this something that the Energy Commission would want to make a statement for the planning board, you know, to say, you know, in this time frame, you should take a look at these other districts, something like that, just to make sure it gets on the agenda.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So what would be, then I would welcome that kind of a motion. But I do think it's kind of odd that there's two different things out there, and we do have some complaints coming in. And we certainly don't want to be a green community that doesn't allow easy access to solar and so on.
Yeah, we should continue to track those either complaints or applications just to understand what the demand is and the
mm-hmm.
limitations are. Just so when that time comes, and say, here's the data.
Right.
Or even from the Solarize Northampton program, like how many folks didn't proceed, sign a contract because of some limitations.
So would the timing be, like you said, next summer would probably be an appropriate time to...
When is the Solarize math supposed to be done?
Well, it's they have a year to do the installs. So the program ended in October. They have a year to do the installs, but they've got 40 in already out of 110.
Okay.
Yeah, so they're moving fast. Winter's settling in, that'll slow them down. But Louis, do you know if they've got more than that now, or I'm not sure if you have a count in your head.
No, I don't keep the count.
Yeah.
I started to look a little bit before I came up here, but it was 5 or 4.
Yeah. I would think that next summer is a good time to do the analysis, not necessarily saying it goes to council in the summer, but sort of to try to get, you know, sit down with Louie, get a sense of the numbers, and, you know, people look at them, and so that might be a good time to do an analysis, aiming to introduce them to council in the fall.
I think the commission could make a recommendation to the planning, you know, send forward a recommendation to the planning department that they move towards reducing the setbacks. And we can put that up sooner rather than later.
Yeah, and my issue is frankly less about not reducing setbacks, but question whether there should be some standard. And I have a problem with ultimately saying there should be the same numbers we have for accessory buildings. But it may be that there we should think about which one's horrible, which one's good as a construction.
Somehow, I mean, it's good to have examples. I mean, it's good to have one to drive by and to understand what could happen.
Because it is about the superstructure to me, not about the panels.
Mm-hmm. Right. Presumably, the technology evolves, particularly with ARPA. I'm sure a lot there's pushback about the aesthetics, just simply because they're new and it's different. Maybe it doesn't jive with a colonial or something, but one would presume that would improve over time, that there would be some manufacturing techniques that at least would address the issues of the superstructure so it didn't look so overt. Although they never got that far, say, with large outdoor air conditioning units, I suppose that they just sort of, they said, okay, these are going to be ugly and they'll stay ugly, you know. That's all we're going to do about it.
And noisy.
Efficient.
They're smaller and quieter.
And that they're too big. Well, it seems like it's over-engineered them. Is that the issue?
No, I mean, one at Riverside is a wood frame structure. It seems like lots of wood.
The owner needed to go up to get up in the air to miss trees because he's only get a small lot in order to get as much as he could.
Raised it up. So
he built
the cell tower. Instead of cutting down his
hands.
Even the same thing with a single metal pole, which is sort of, it's not like it's a technology. There's lots of places that use a single metal pole with these things cantilevered off of them.
So this PT structure with.
It's engineered. He had to get an engineer. Yeah, we wouldn't let him just build something like that.
But it looks like he just built it.
Okay, it's not that consuming, so.
and he was doing it because of the specific challenges for the site. And if it weren't green, pressure-treated lumber.
There are chickens living under it.
Right. I mean, in the end, all these arguments usually come down to territorial conflicts. I mean, people complaining about what a neighbor is doing that somehow impacts their viewscape or at least their sense of their place. And to what extent does a neighbor have the right or the authority to complain about how crappy your place looks beyond just complaining? And then when it becomes codified is when it becomes an issue. And that's when we start making rules regulating people's sensibilities, it gets really tricky.
There is another issue which could come up at some point. I've only heard this from one person when it came to. But as we deal with things close to the property boundaries, and those are subtly property boundaries, people are going to start asking for California-style solar access rights. And I think that's more of a concern.
Mm-hmm. What are the California-style?
You can't just plant trees that would block your...
Right. Oh, no, I'm sorry. That's what I remember reading about that there's actually impacting and impeding their access to sunlight.
Right.
And energy generation.
They have a different system of law in California. The way they deal with water is completely different than the way they deal with water in New England. I mean, it's based, it has a different basis. And I think it extends a little bit to the zoning. That's like on the Colorado River, having water.
Right, well, that's because they steal it from other states to subsidize a desert.
Prior appropriations.
But you essentially own the water when it's on your property. And so you can take the water out. And there's regulations about that, true ownership.
So in the course of a matter of time facilitation, does anybody want to put forth a motion? Or are we just going to accept the fact that Wayne's here and part of this conversation and he's the head of the department of planning?
The motion would essentially ask that, or The motion be that the Energy Commission recommends reviewing the setback standards to have them make more sense for application and fairness, is that?
Right, review the setback requirements for small ground-mounted solar arrays.
So two, I'm absolutely fine with that, I wouldn't object at all. The other approach is to plan to put it on our agenda in June, when we sort of had some of this experience, and have this commission start working through more of those issues, what's been better sense.
I mean, I would prefer to do in that, rather than have some formal motion that we vote on,
okay.
I think it's on Wayne's radar, it's in Wayne's radar, and that I think that's appropriate, because we haven't got enough feedback. We have one complaint about one array on, and then we have some complaints that Louis is receiving, and he'll likely get more as Solarize Northampton starts to finish its build out. And then we'll have a pretty good sense of what people's tolerances are, I think, at some level. So I think that'd be more appropriate way to go.
And I think it's not, the planning department knows about this stuff, in that sense, and Carol and I meet and have discussions about sort of all these issues every single week. And she sees the nuts and bolts proposals and issues with the proposals, and the kind of back and forth.
Okay?
Yeah, I agree.
Very good, we'll move on to the next. Excellent. Thank you for having the conversation. So input on the new stretch code. I bring this up because actually maybe Aiden, you've asked for this on the agenda for a couple times.
Uh-huh.
And now it seems quite timely because the review process is happening. Both you and I and Louis all went to the information and feedback session in Amherst last week. And they have a very formal email site to accept input, and they have a PowerPoint where they're asking for very specific topics to give comment on. So with all that, I thought this was a good time to bring it up on this agenda, particularly where we actually had time and didn't have to push it up. So do you want to say anything else? Didn't you ask for this to be on this?
Sure. Well, I asked for it to be on because we knew that the stretch code was changing with a new base energy code, and that date is July 1st, 2014. So as a green community and as the advanced energy code is a pretty important way to ensure new buildings are energy efficient, it's a pretty important issue for this commission. So as Chris said, last Wednesday, DOER came from Boston to have these information sessions. And nothing was very surprising, except it was pretty clear they're very serious about maintaining the existing stretch code, but kind of taking it up the next level so that it's a little bit better than the new base code, which is going up. The issue is that if we don't do anything in the stretch code, then the base code will actually be better than the stretch code, and we'll be called the ground community, not a green community. So something will happen. And the folks from DOER are interested in maintaining the performance requirements, the HERS rating approach, and making it pretty substantial. Actually, I think it's very substantial what they were talking about, changing it from HERS 70 for a house under 3,000 square feet to kind of reference 60, down to 60.
Or more. I mean, they had made two suggestions, either from 70 to 55 or 70 to 60, depending on whether they tried to make it 15 or 20% better than the current or the base energy code. Mm-hmm. So it ended up being there's a lot of work that happens under the prescriptive requirements of the code, and they talked about just simply raising the amount, the U-value, the insulated value of windows and walls by a certain percentage also.
Yeah, the 55 you referenced, I missed that they were considering that because I left early, but the 2015 code that's already in process has a performance path of 55. So they're looking, I heard 60 is kind of the main difference. That's a pretty big jump. And
this question, so I understand this, because we always talk about how conservation is better than, you know, using energy, even if it's renewable energy. So I'm just looking at these things. These are, I assume, our PERS ratings in the way of numbers in the record.
Right. Yeah.
So some of these things are incredibly low because they're super insulated.
And renewable energy.
Well, that's what I'm going to say. But so either one counts. Like, you know, I'd rather a house be 45.
They didn't used to count. It didn't used to count the HERS rating, and now it does. And so some of the older numbers, and those, some of the older numbers have gone off the top. And so a few of the numbers that came in didn't have the peak of photovoltaic solar counted in, and now it does count.
See, I really think it's great to have solar PV. It just seems weird that I can build a house that's a HERS rating of 70 and put a 6 kilowatt array up and get a HERS rating of 20. It seems like the owner should be, here's your true HERS rating.
There's two things. One is there's also a prescriptive requirements, so there's mandatory things that also have to happen, including air barrier checklist and air hole building air tightness. So things that if you were clearly slating away from building the envelope, you would fail those things.
The HERS rating is relatively sophisticated in the sense that they do a whole envelope conservation, minimize energy use in the envelope. And now, if you add solar to the roof, it can reduce the number, but it's still going to have a tight envelope.
But a tight envelope that would get you to like what HERS rating?
Yeah, you can't really get below 45 without renewable energy. Well, really, 40 is probably as low as you can get, even super,
yeah.
Almost passive house.
I mean, it depends on who you want to listen to and how much, you know, diminishing returns on investment.
Yeah. A practical house, so solar really helps that, but it's interesting. So my comment at the meeting, and I wrote this in written comment, is that the specific number and dropping it, you know, down as low as possible is less important than compliance, making sure that builders understand the requirements, that building officials reinforce it, and that it's kind of people are taking it seriously. And, like, that's more important because that's how we'll save more energy statewide than just saying, you know, let's get as low as possible.
The list that I brought is the new construction that was subject to the sketch code. And what happened between July 12 and June 13. And some of them were permitted before that, and they've just closed out during that time period, and then others haven't closed out yet. But if we look at 55, we look at the HERS rating going to 55, about half of the houses that were done in this time period wouldn't pass. So we're looking at if you go to 60, then it's probably about 40% of the houses that were done wouldn't pass as constructed. So we are looking at if that's the numbers they adopt for the stretch code, we're definitely looking at ratcheting up the energy conservation measures that have to go into a house, which would be primarily insulation. We permitted two houses that are in the negatives, negative 22, and they only have enough, they only have 125% of capacity solar on the roof. So I think they're going to be in the 35s. If you took the solar out of the equation, I think they'd be at about hers of about 35. They're small, they're relatively expensive, but they'll both be done by, I think, mid-year next year. I think that'll be interesting. I think, Mary, you know what you went
Carter
through.
Carter Scott?
What?
Is it Carter Scott?
I can't remember the name. It's two houses on Laurel Street that's part of the old, they were carved off of the piece that Cole Morgan ended up on.
So Louis, of these right here, the ones that are let's say, well, above 55 or below 55. Do you have a sense, is that because of the builder or because of the owner and what they're looking for? Or simply is it, is some of it just the builder and the owner are basically just trying to get under whatever they can do to get?
There's two groups of folks. Ones that are just trying to meet the standards so that they can get the certificate of occupancy. And the other ones that are, and some of these houses were done under spec. They weren't necessarily done under, with a contract. And so the owner was the contractor at that point. And they're willing to get into the, I'm thinking of the Picoy project, where they're willing to get into the below 50 on spec because they knew that the people were going to come and look at it. And they seem pretty successful with relatively straightforward construction methods, to be able to get under 50. But they're knowledgeable and they're practiced and they're building the same house over and over and over again, which is in terms of the construction details, so it makes it pretty easy. By the third time Chuck's gone out and showed them how to do it, they're pretty much starting to get it.
To do that, they have to have an 8-inch cabinet? 8-12.
Say again?
To do that, the walls have to be 8 inches?
No, they're doing 6 inches of type, a foam, continuous insulation under the siding, and stuff like that.
Yeah, that's an example of techniques, and very specific techniques that would get you almost all the way, like continuous insulation, which is required just north of us starting next year. Every new building will need that. And here, builders who are really forward-thinking and talk to their clients about the extra expense. But it's a few things, really, to do that. The one thing I'll add is that the base code airtightness is more than being cut in half next year. So from 7 air changes per hour to 3.
I think of all things, that might be the most problem.
Yeah, and it's going to be a big deal. So builders, whether they're in a green community or not, will have to really wrap their mind around that, hopefully before they're going to get their permit on the design stage. But just by hitting that 3, you're going to get that much further down to fit towards 50. So there's a lot of, just by saying, if this changes tomorrow, we have to remember that everyone statewide is going to have to get better because of the prescriptive mandatory requirements and performance mandatory requirements. So it's not just, those base code requirements are going to get them mostly there anyways.
So one thing that they asked very specifically about, I'll put it two ways. At the meeting, they gave us suggested improvements that they've already gotten from people. Further streamline the commercial prescriptive code, support renewable energy integration. So people are trying to say to support renewable energy in this. Improve indoor air quality requirements, support combined heat and power, that's on the commercial side. Add a HERS tier for multifamily units, this was recommended. Align with the latest ASHRAE lighting standards, use best practices from around the country. So I'll mention those, but then they did ask very specifically, how much do people want to support renewables? I remember, as part of it. Wayne, your very point there, and if the commission has any kind of opinions on that, that's like one place where I think we could put a note into them and say, the Energy Commission would prefer that you drive hard on the energy efficiency before you give any points for renewables, for instance. I hope I'm stating what you just said, Wayne. Yeah. Okay.
I mean, they're not going to change the HER system, so they can't change the software.
Okay.
You know what I mean, so I don't know how they would change how much solar is weighed in unless they add an additional line item like you have to consider solar.
I think they can click it out.
I
see.
I think solar is great. It's almost like I'd rather you say you have to be the minimum HERS rating of 55 or 60
right.
before you include PV,
right, yeah.
and
yeah.
then include the PV. It's great to bring
right.
the
HERS
down.
But
and thresholds are better and easier to understand too as you're going forward. So I think I'd be really. And if the threshold set to the point where it incentivizes people for conservation before they actually do.
That's a good point.
Probably easier to lay out than some complicated algorithm that would make my head explode. So,
you know, for some portion of the contractors, and I think people who are, you know, buying the houses, it's not going to be so much incentivizing as forcing. I mean, the code is going to drive the HERS ratings down rather than, you know, the incentives going down. There's going to be some subset of it. One thing that I did research was that there were alternatives in the stretch code to allow people, when they did additions or renovations, to use prescriptive code requirements or performance requirements. Prescriptive being this much insulation, this much this kind of windows, and then performance being essentially getting a HERS rating done on whether it's your renovation or your addition. And everybody that we dealt with opted for the prescriptive solution.
Because they're scared?
I would suspect partly for a practical matter, right? Well, I think it's, and Aiden could speak to this, but I think it's pretty difficult to be able to do a HERS, to come up with a HERS rating for a complete renovation on a house, or especially in addition, how do you carve off the specifics of the addition.
It's an expensive process if you're dealing with an existing house that may have only 2x4 cavities, and what if you need to improve it, it's hard.
But the prescriptive requirements are fairly robust. I think the biggest thing is the air sealing, that the increase in the requirements for air sealing are making a big difference.
One thing while you're thinking on that is the DOR talked a lot about professional development for builders, and that they wanted to focus resources on that. I know that they can help educate builders get up, you know, use better techniques and stuff. Maybe we could interface with them around that. Remember, you mentioned something around sizing, you know, issues of HVAC contractors not sizing equipment properly, which is a big issue I face every day. Just like, you know, they drag their feet to sign the form that they need the utilities to say they have sized the systems. They don't need to show me the manual J, they just need to sign it saying they sized it. And they wait and they drag and they ask if I can do it. And just like it's required by code, right? It's written there, you know, and for efficiency, your system doesn't work unless it meets the needs of the building. So if we can, as a community, interface with contractors locally around that and help DOER either getting the word out or at least bringing people to a training session or something, and also kind of open the conversation, you know, like we have CET in there, it does more HERS ratings in Western Mass than anyone. And we have, you know, very proactive building inspectors. So if we can be kind of open the dialogue in some kind of forum as part of this DOER effort, that would be great. And I'd be happy to work on that.
I know, I think that, thank you for bringing that up. That was one of the ones that I thought was a key thing as well, is that there was a lot of kind of push and shove between, you know, what value are you going to get from the HERS rater. But it basically boiled down to, does the contractor and the installer know what they're doing? And meaning your point, Aiden, on, you know, having meeting compliance is more important than pushing the rating down, that speaks to, again, training. You know, if they don't know how to do it, they're not going to make the compliance. So it's really important that these folks are trained. I'll add to that, CET was doing training for a while, and they have now dropped that from the program. And I understood from one conversation I had with someone at CET that was because they weren't getting anybody to go to them. So, so a difficult nut to crack. You know, they need training, but they're not willing to go out and get the training. Mary.
So what the Northeast Sustainable Energy Association is starting to do is do small trainings directed. And we're just starting this thing, it's called a Pro Tour. And so we're gonna be, and I wanna talk to you about this because I think it would be very easy to do this. Basically, it's the next generation green buildings open house. So it's for the professionals. You get a tour of a couple of locations so that they can see the stuff and see the hands-on actual, the stuff going up. And then they look at a couple of locations, they all meet back in a conference room, they talk to all the architects and the builders and the project people on the project, And it's not so much a workshop that's teaching them code, but it could either build up to that. We're also working with the DOER on a side thing at our conference. We're going to run a two-day workshop for realtors, running the Green Realtors accreditation program that started up in the Pacific Northwest with Earth Advantage. So we're working with DOER on that one. And I bet we could do stuff with you, and they could maybe, we can address this in a couple of ways that's less like bring all the people here to tell them exactly what they don't know, but hey, you're a professional, we're going to give you a tour and we're going to give you a workshop and you get to talk to people and, you know, get started that way. And the pro tours have been really, we've done about 6 or 8 of them across different places, and they've been very, very popular. Small groups, 25 people.
And that, do you think you're bringing people on board who just need to learn techniques, they don't know it? Or is it bringing the folks on board who just really know they're into this kind of stuff that like to talk about?
There's a whole different range. There's a whole set of people who are all, you know, it depends on who, how, depends on if we can get the Western Mass Home Builders and Brad Campbell and, you know, on board, because those are the guys we need. But he won't do anything unless unless there's something in it for them financially. And that's really hard to do, you know.
So towards that end, I would ask the question, is there anything the city can do? I mean, for Northampton, it's great that it all develops statewide, but Northampton, we would want our residents to have access to well-trained, knowledgeable contractors and installers. Is there anything Northampton can do that's either a carrot or a stick?
Always fees, but weigh the extra amount of people who think start my training.
I mean, if there is, then that's something I think would be really worth talking about. So
one of the things that you get to, when you get to a building and you're at the point when you're beginning to look at the energy conservation elements of the building, what you find is that what you need to do is simple, but it's not easy. It's laborious, and so people don't want to sit down and do it. Vinyl siding, slap it up. Wood shingles, fairly laborious. You have to put a lot of thought and energy into putting up a decent wood shingle siding or roof, and just as you do when you're trying to build a house that's going to get a good HERS rating. It's just one detail after another. There's some pretty good guides out there. I mean, you know, if you couldn't ask for better literature that shows you how to do it, but it's 85 pages, and, you know, you're going to drag this 85-page thing around, plus this 2-page checklist, plus... So what happens is the inspector shows up, and we spend as much time as we can, but basically, we're pass or fail people. And, you know, we educate to the degree we can, but there's certainly a time constraint. And, you know, we need at that point, we need an educator.
Yeah, I think what's hard to come up with that meaning also is who's responsible for educating builders,
right?
Like, people are like, some of you are like, it's the HERS rater, needs to give us more if we're not paying them. The other people are like, the HERS rater is only there for clients, and then inspectors, of course, they're maxed out, but they always go above. So there's that question, unless we get grant money to lead trainings or to do some kind of workshop type thing, like how is it possible?
Well, you need certification to be a contractor. But what I'm saying is that, I mean, part of the problem is this element was kind of eliminated because various communities are employing stretch code, whereas other communities are not. So
I think you need education, but I'll tell you, don't have to, I mean, you could bring that seat cushion and both of you could get certification. It really isn't, I mean.
So, I mean, that's a problem. I mean, if there was some form of registry, for instance, or qualification, registration, certificate,
it's a CSI, right? Or CSL.
Yeah, construction supervisor's license. And there is a requirement for education, but you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. And in this situation, the horses have to show up, they don't have to drink. And they get there, and they meet their educational requirements,
right,
which is what's required to to, you know, continue with your license.
Even, Chris, the CET training was a review of the code book. It was a $50, 2 hour, just let's go through the code book real quick. It wasn't a...
Oh, okay. So
here's three options for a successful wall system.
That wasn't really a technology training.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was a code review.
Yeah. I mean, it would explain the trend towards prescriptive, following prescriptive measures, because otherwise you're just making it up. If you haven't got a clue, you're making it up and going along and hoping to God you just, it passes when all things are said and done. But if it's prescriptive, we say, look, we did everything.
Then we go there and we say, well, we didn't do that, and
right.
We didn't do that, but it's all little things. But,
little things, you know, it's the punch list that kills the person paying for the project. It's the punch list that puts the contractor on site longer than they wanted to be, and backing up jobs. And it would seem to me, you know, on one level, the market would start to drive this. It would serve as some incentive, if you want to build products in Northampton and do quality products and turnover, that it makes sense if you figure out how to seal a house correctly, how to insulate it correctly, what, you know, all the standards that are prescribed in the code, and that takes a lot longer.
Mary's house was, I mean, you're the poster child for how it can work. An architect and a contractor and an owner who are all motivated in the same direction, and it works real well. But you don't usually get all three. Or alternately, you could look down this list and you could look at the numbers, and below 50, that was what was happening. And above 50, that wasn't what was happening. You can't look back at the older, you have to look at, it doesn't count. So these numbers are skewed in the sense that the older numbers are going to be inherently higher because they couldn't make as many credits.
I have a quick comment about the construction supervisor's license issue. So we have a lot of members who are builders who have to get the construction supervisor's license accreditation now that Mass has required that. So I went to the state and got approval to accredit the whole fundamentals track at our conference, which Mark Newey of CET is one of the track chairs. So who's the other guy, Brian Legg, whose dad used to be the National Grid program manager. So they have developed a whole fundamentals track that we're crediting for builders, so hopefully we'll get some people there. We're also going to accredit probably the homes track for the Tim Coppingers and, you know, the other Mary Quigleys and the other people who are, you know, already high-performance builders, so that they can not waste their time in the basic courses that really don't, you know, that people have to go to and not get real education for. So we're actually providing the high performance construction supervisors license credits. So I'd love to know if there's anyone who needs to know about those who can offer those to them and the realtors. It's so funny, it's all piecemeal though. You know, it's like, you know, we need some education here, and they need it out at, just, you know, it's crazy.
Stuff for contractors, I was a contractor, you wake up at 5:45 and, you know, make your lunch, get to work, and then work all day, and, you know, usually kind of behind, and so you work as late as you can, and then you come home and do estimates and bills, and then you go to sleep, and then you wake up and you do it again, and that's sort of what it takes to make a living as a contractor. I don't know. I never knew a contractor that didn't work that way. Of course, I mean, these are the folks I worked with, and that was sort of the work ethic in that group of people, but it's pretty much the way it worked out. So it's hard to get them loose. If we could work something out where we could gather, you know, a small group of contractors in a house that had the external envelope air sealing done, and then walk them around. That might be useful. But I don't know how you work that out.
Think back, you said before, that sort of takes three people working together. You know,
right.
And it seems, at least in my world, not energy, but in terms of who follows regulations, it seems like there's a clear divide between contractors. There's some contractors who are cutting every corner and some contractors who are really good. And it seems like the challenge with training is it's easy to get the ones who are really good, but the amount of the ones who are really good. They're not able to do it.
So I've got a question. This is going to kind of digress a little bit, but is there any one part of this that's really difficult for the contractors that, you know, in other cases, you know, contractors don't do electrical because that's the electrician's going to do it. They don't do plumbing. I mean, is it time to have an insulator or an air sealer who you call in at a certain time and they just do that piece really well?
You certainly can do it. It's a question
of, is it too integrated?
It's competitive bidding and who shows up to do the insulation. There's certainly as much of a difference between the insulation, the people who actually stand there and do the insulation, as there is from, you know, in any group with, say, contractors. I think the only way that you can drag the contractors who cut corners forward is by failing the inspections. And then, at some point, you become motivated to avoid the failure. It's easier to do it once and go through it the whole time than it is to do it in a less inadequate fashion, and then go back, because we won't point out every single thing. We'll, when we do an inspection, we'll point to some number of things and say, these are the kind of things you need to deal with, and then when we go back, we don't look for every, we don't take a crayon and mark every little problem. We talk about whether what is not ready, but and you go back how many times, and eventually they start to get, you might start to incentivize them in that process, but there have been contractors where it didn't work out.
I think, Chris, I think the thing that's missing from the general contractor is there's the concept that the thermal boundary is something they need to check off their list. They have all their subs, they're the project manager, and the continuous thermal boundary and thinking about the air barrier, they just need to spend some time and know who's responsible. Or, they should be responsible for making sure it's all continuous and make sure that their subs are doing what they need to do. And it's just that, they need to just add that to their, all the stuff they're thinking of, one more thing, because that will get them, 80% of the way to where they need to be. It's almost on the design front, things, it's not bar value and all that.
Yeah, when the contractor's done, the doors in all cabinets want to hang nice and straight, and they all go through and they all put their time and energy into that, because it's, when somebody walks into the kitchen, the doors are all skewed. They aren't impressed. So, but the work we're talking about is absolutely concealed.
On the present time, we have one more thing I have to get to. If I was to put a comment in for the Energy Commission, would it be appropriate for me to say that reaching a specific PERS level first before bringing PV in is a preference for the Northampton legacy? Maybe. Okay, if no one else.
In new construction, you're talking about.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
We're talking about new construction. And then the training, I'll just welcome any ideas people have towards a carrot or a stick. And I really would. I mean, I think. Or training ideas. I mean, if the Pro Tour of Green Building Open House really works to get people working on it. But I think that is, one of the, if we can get contractors trained or installers trained to do something well, then you've gotten rid of so many problems. It's the reason why they give rebates to Home Depot for LED lights. No one else has to apply for them. LED, they just buy it down, and you're going to get a good product when you get there. So I would welcome any ideas this commission comes up with.
Maybe a comment on that could be that their training efforts that they've said they're committed to are focused on local communities, and them reaching out to local community point people to design and make those trainings with the professionals in that community. So it's not about some suit from Boston coming out and telling them about talking to a HERS rater and an inspector and the process and that, but it's the people in that community that they will be working with, that they do work with every day, and somehow get them to come to meetings. I don't know if repeats will do it, but
It's surprising how a tour is really helpful.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Do you know Carter Scott of Transformations? He's actually trying to do a whole bunch of net zero housing out in East Hampton.
Yeah, he's the person.
Yeah, that's doing that. And he's like such a, he's very super motivated and super like passionate about this net zero stuff. And he was at this net zero leadership summit in California that I went to as well. And so he's trying to convince the state to get on board with the net zero plan that's like California's plan. And he would be more than happy to show people this is how you do it. And his buildings are super simple and they're all net zero. You know, so they're not like aesthetically, you know, they're not fancy.
I think
they're basic, but they would show people the basics.
One challenge to that is that it's hard to say this is how you do it to builders who don't do that approach, and that part of these trainings have to be like, here's your goal.
Absolutely.
Here it be different. But you know, but walking through an example is helpful
for
a contractor. But I think the challenge of the trainings is that it really is here's a target for the code. And here are a bunch of different ways to do it.
Okay. So towards that, I'll add that if I put something up to them as comment back, then I will agree with them. What we heard in the agenda training is essential, and then I will encourage them to reach out to the local community, and reach out and coordinate with local contractors who are doing it right, to come up with to work with us. Don't just come up with a training in Boston. Come in and talk, work in your local communities to discover what training is going to work for those local contractors. Okay? And if no one objects, I can put that out there as well.
And the other thing, I don't know if it's possible, but they should look into the data that's available. For instance, all these HERS ratings have the same data sets for what is the wall system, what is the attic, what is the basement, et cetera, et cetera. And it'd be great to just see that, you know, as part of their training. Like, look, these are 30% of the jobs have continuous grid insulation on the outside. 95% of these jobs have high efficiency. You know, so then I think some data, and that for them to design their trainings around existing data, probably from Thursday.
Okay. So with that, Brian, you're...
Yeah, I was just going to ask you, before I get to my part, I was just wondering about the Voc Tech and whether or not we could bring them into this. It's an educational facility, Saturday mornings, a couple of hours. The other thing I was thinking about while I was listening to everybody is that my younger daughter is a physician's assistant, and in order to keep her certification, she has to take 20 continuing education units every year or every 2 years. And I'm wondering if in order to become a licensed contractor in Northampton, the city of Northampton, maybe we require 5 units of education each year. Maybe a 2-hour Saturday morning workshop would be two credits. So you just put it out there for these guys if they want it. And what you show them is what you want to show them, you know, the tightness and there's probably a lot of stuff that they think they're doing well. And, you know, those are the guys you want to really see because then you want to show them how they really could do it well. And so, I mean, I'm thinking of those two parts, the educational part of the licensing and also the use of the school and the teachers and the facilities.
Is that something that we actually could do? I mean, licensing is done at state level, right?
It is.
Can the community require any kind of additional?
Well, I think we're stuck with carrots in that case.
Okay.
I don't think we have the opportunity to.
So many builders don't live in the community, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the challenge.
Okay.
And they don't just do business in this community.
But we have a way to accredit courses so that they can get their credits by attending our stuff, because I would do that.
They need 12 or 15 credits a year, I think. Mm-hmm. Think that they need to get, and that's essentially 12 or 15 hours, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of the people are putting on these blitz programs where it's all day Saturday and half the day Sunday and you're done.
Or you put your computer on over here and I'll give you the credit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking of next year giving a big discount, might be like 30% or something, for builders that show they're consistent with good HERS ratings, because it's so much less time if you're not holding someone's hand through the process.
That's great.
So that's an incentive.
Great. Okay. Yep, time-wise, right?
Yep, thank you. Chris had sent out a notice to us all a while back telling us about an Energy Star webinar that took place on December 4th. And, I was interested in it from a personal level and also because of the commission. So I volunteered to attend it and I took as many notes as I could. But one of the, and I just wrote
just,
down some highlights.
Energy Star construction or appliances?
There's an Energy Star score that they want to come up with. They're developing. They're not there yet. And they want to be able to give the building the Energy Star score of anywhere from 1 to 100. The higher the score, obviously, the better off you are. And let me just...
But this is the same Energy Star, the EPA Energy Star program.
Exactly. But it's for multifamily homes. That's what this particular thing is about. And one of the things that I wrote here was... The very last sentence was, a hard copy of the information presented webinar will be posted online and emailed to registered participants as soon as possible, but I've not yet received it. Well, 5 minutes before 4, it came over, and I forwarded it to you as well.
Okay.
So, I mean, the whole thing is all there, all the charts and everything. But I just wanted to summarize. There were four people involved with the webinar. Michael Katz, who I don't know who he is, but... And there was a gentleman named Andrew Schulte. Alexandra Sullivan is the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency Energy Star Program supervisor. And Donna Varner is a vice president for Fannie Mae. So it kind of gives you the idea of who was running this. And then on top of that, there were 500 to 600 registered participants online at this one webinar. The focus of the webinar was multifamily buildings, summary of data analysis and determination of Energy Star score. Apparently a lot of push is being made to try to develop a program which will generate an Energy Star score for multifamily properties. According to Donna Varner, Fannie Mae manages 22% of all multifamily, of the multifamily mortgage market. Fannie Mae offers a Green Performance Plus program whereby they will loan up to 85% of loan value as opposed to the standard 80% of property of loan value. The additional edge of 5 percentage points requires a level 2 energy audit, which I didn't know what a level 2 was, but and they didn't go into it much. And a determination as an affordable property based on energy usage. According to Alexander Sullivan, an energy usage index and an Energy Star score, 1 to 100, as I said, are the objectives of the EPA. These factors will assist an owner to qualify for better rates on loans, become more attractive to prospective tenants, and should make the property more valuable should the owner try and sell it. Repeated mention of the EPA's portfolio manager software as a property management tool for owners and managers. This is a no-cost software that allows property owners and managers to collect and compare information on water and energy consumption and greenhouse emissions, comparing their properties, for example, to national averages. Although other major metro markets were included in this preliminary review survey, New York Metro was considered the horse that pulls the cart, mandating that every other market be compared to it. The webinar consisted primarily of charts and graphs comparing low, medium, and high-rise multifamily buildings and the size of the footprint on the property as relates to energy usage, so much per square footage or so much per bedroom or so much whatever. Apartments per floor, bedrooms per apartment, etc. were also some of the variables that were studied. The surprise in the findings was that high-rise multifamilies are less efficient overall than a low-rise building with a larger footprint. and they rhetorically asked the question when they presented that fact. They asked us to submit over online as we were doing the webinar why we felt that might be the case. And the only suggestion I had was that high rises might have a lot more common area, so that the energy going into the common area is not really amortized over the number of units and number of bedrooms and so forth. A discussion was held in regards to actually getting the information either directly from landlords, property managers, or third parties. Not all seem forthcoming when it comes to providing data such as 1, number of residents per apartment, income levels of tenants, and cost of energy used for the building. Common area expenses available, the total building usage is not. Somebody who owns the whole building and pays for all the utilities and so forth of that building can give the information, but most situations, at least in my situation, in the properties I own, I don't pay the utilities for anybody. They pay their own. The EPA states that the data they're collecting is a moving target, but predicts the preliminary finding of their research will be available February 2014. At that time, they will present more of their findings and predict when the Energy Star Score program might be available. They're saying there is no way the Energy Star Score program will be available by February 2014, but at least they will have a better idea as to when it will be available by that time. So now, I mean, I can go through all this information and maybe do a follow-up presentation next meeting or whatever you want me to do, but that was kind of where we are, and they're going to be doing more and more and more stuff. It's a long process, I understand.
But I'll say I kind of have 3 things out of that myself. One is the fact that there's some kind of a financial benefit that Fannie Mae is developing around this Green Performance Plus.
Mm-hmm.
So that's interesting. If there's some way we can give some financial benefit to someone going green, I don't know the details. I'll go online and look.
Okay.
The second one is the fact that they're trying to use the portfolio manager, which we used to use too.
Okay.
And the advantage of it is that it does, you can kind of compare yourself to national averages, and I don't think they didn't have multifamily, so you know, they can only compare what they have loaded up there. So
right.
They need a lot of multifamily examples, and they're having a hard time with that.
Yeah.
I got that. Oh, and what was the third point? Oh, just the fact that they're trying to come up with a rating system for HERS. I mean, a rating system for multifamily. You know, right now we just talk about the stretch code. Will it be, did I mention that? That's something they're looking at, is doing HERS rating for multifamilies. Okay, I didn't mention that. Right, so something that I think is highly needed. So it'd be interesting to kind of keep that in mind going forward. And Ryan, if you send that, you sent me the PowerPoint.
Yeah, I didn't send you my summary. I can do that if you want.
Sure, and I'll pass it on to everybody just so you all have it. Need be. And folks want to let me know if you want to hear more on this, or maybe in February we try to touch base on it again.
I know the Energy Star residential new homes program is falling off the cliff. Seems like I've had one person ask about it and no one go through with it because it's so stringent that it takes so much additional work to get an Energy Star labeled home, and then the market value of it in this market at least isn't substantial.
Stretch code would be it.
Exactly.
That's part of it. So, yeah. Right, why?
Everybody send a net zero and pass it out.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just going to mention the last thing, ongoing projects. I just noticed when I looked at the minutes from last time, when I reported for our solarize was what the state told us, and we now have final numbers. 715 kilowatts, 110 people. More than 3 times the tier 5 level that we had to get to.
Can you say that again? Put it on Facebook right now.
What's that?
I'll post it right to Facebook right now.
He's going to Facebook right now.
715 kilowatts.
He's a social media monster.
Contracted for 715 kilowatts, 110 contracts.
Yep.
Yeah, or families, right? Yeah. And, in order to get to tier 5, we needed 200 kilowatts. So we are well over 3 times as much.
3 times.
Yeah. As the tier 5, and some communities don't reach tier 5. So. And anybody want to move to adjourn?
Sure.
I'll move to adjourn, because it's my last meeting.
This is Pam, yeah, I was going to say, this is Pam's last meeting.
Thank you all very much for your companionship and partnership in this noble endeavor.
Well, thank you, Pam, for your...
You go forth in good health and, you know, less consumption of less energy.
Are you going to another commission?
No, I'm not asking.
No, I have to note that Pam does this with the same smile she announces every last meeting that she's about to... She's really going to work on looking more sad.
I so appreciate my service. It's been awesome. It's been absolutely awesome. I'm really grateful for it. And, it, you know, there's a time for everything. Time to pass
the baton. She didn't run for council yet, so she won't be a council.
I'm being succeeded by a fabulous person, Gina Louise Chiara.
Okay.
She's just great, so we're all in great hands, and it's a win-win.
Is she interested in this commission?
I don't know. It'll be a whole new, it's a whole new council. Not a whole
right,
new council.
Right, the council president has to...
He could become an associate member.
I could.
I smile on a little bit edge to it.
Yeah.
So the council president, I think by order, has to be part of this committee, so there's only one other. And in this case, I'm the council president, so that you guys pulled the short straw with me, but it was the... depending on who's council president next time, maybe me.
Yeah, I wonder.
It may be me, but in that leaves one more opening. Paul Specker has, he was really key in it.
That's
so,
true.
And he's already been on.
This is clearly a lucky spot, that's what I said. It's a lucky spot.
I made Ian
no
Pamela.
No with awesome people. I mean, it's a lucky spot.
They had to do rock, paper, scissors for 2 hours.
Yeah.
That's all right. Speaks a lot to the other.
Yeah. Oh, no, we're being recorded still, but
yeah, we'll keep them up. Is there a second to Pam's?
A second.
Okay, there you go. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.